Now, it is my honor and pleasure to introduce you to our guest speaker, Dr. Ayana Jordan. She is an assistant professor of psychiatry in the Yale School of Medicine, the associate program director of the Yale Psychiatry Residency Program, the director of the Social Justice and Health Equity Curriculum, and the director of Yale Global Mental Health Program within the residency. Dr. Jordan is an expert in supporting minority populations affected by substance use disorder. She is committed to increasing access to addiction services within minority communities, both within the United States and abroad in her research activities and clinical practice. She is also the medical director of Recognizing and Eliminating Disparities in Culturally Informed Healthcare Program, also known as the REACH program, which is a 5-year initiative funded by SAMHSA jointly with the American Academy of Addiction Psychiatry, which aims to increase the number of addiction specialists from racial and ethnic minority populations who obtain training in how to provide culturally informed addiction treatment. Dr. Jordan is also the principal investigator of the Imani Breakthrough Project, a faith-based recovery initiative that takes place in 7 churches, predominantly serving Black and Latinx communities. In addition, Dr. Jordan is working on a pilot study to provide a computer-based cognitive behavior therapy program called CBT for CBT within the Black Church. Dr. Jordan is the proud recipient of various clinical and research awards, and she was recently inducted into the Top 40 Under 40 Society by Hampton University, her undergraduate alma mater. Dr. Jordan completed her MD-PhD training at Albert Einstein College of Medicine of Yeshiva University and completed a general adult psychiatry residency and specialized training in addiction psychiatry at Yale University. On a personal note, I am thrilled to be a Reg Scholar for this next academic year, and I'm looking forward to working with Dr. Jordan and the REACH team in addressing structural inequities that obstruct improved mental health in the Latinx community. So please join me to welcome Dr. Ayana Jordan.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me. I am so grateful that you all took the time to be with me today and learn together as we talk about structural racism in this country. I want to also just thank Dr. Arbella Cruz for that wonderful introduction. As she was reading, I said, wow, that sounds like an amazing person, and I would love to meet her. So I appreciate you and your authenticity and your description of me. That was lovely, and I'm so excited to have you as a REACH scholar. So with that, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. It's interesting because when I was first invited to give this talk, the recent murders had not taken place. So I always say the universe knows what information needs to be disseminated at a timely manner. And so I'm so grateful that the Boston Medical Center had the foresight to invite me today. Please join me as we talk about COVID-19 is terrible, but I'm more likely to die from structural racism. Before we get started, I'd like to collectively, please, wherever you are, stop what you're doing, don't read. If you're able to just close your eyes, as we collectively have a moment of silence, for the Black bodies that were murdered at the hands of racist structures in this country, many of which included the police. Our time will start now. Thank you all. I just wanted to note that that was only 30 seconds, and that seemed like a very long time, but I want to bring to the forefront that George Floyd, who was killed most recently, had the police officer's knee on his neck for 8 minutes and 46 seconds. So we can have an appreciation for how long it took for him to go to his death. I also want to bring in my patient, Mubarak Salomon. I can say his name because his death is now public, who was killed by the West Haven police last year, and his murderer remains free. We are entering into a liberated space together. I try and be very purposeful to ground conversations that I have, especially when I'm talking about structural violence, structural racism, and healthcare disparity, because people often center a safe space, and I reject that notion. It has a lot of good intent, meaning that we don't say things that'll hurt one another. We want to be respectful of people. And that sounds good, but in reality, growth often comes from conflict or uncomfortableness. So through this presentation, I want you to be comfortable with being uncomfortable. You might learn some words or language that you never heard before. And just realize that as we enter into this liberated space together, I am going to express some of my own opinions, many of which are rooted in the literature, but also what may seem controversial to white America, but it's what Black people have known for so long, that our bodies are not valued. So in that, I welcome any questions. Please do bring them to this liberated space so that we can learn together. It's not our intent to hurt one another, but to join together in this space to learn. So many people, academic institutions, including my own, which in my opinion was very weak in response to the murders of Black people in these past few days, have sent out statements in response to the killings of Black people. And it's so ironic that the statement that resonated with me most is that from the ice cream company, Ben and Jerry. And they centered Black folks' lives to say, the murders of Black people are not a result of bad apples. A lot of people keep saying it's just a few bad apples. And I want us to really center white supremacy as the reason why Black people continue to be killed. So I'm just going to read straight from their website. The murder of George Floyd, and I will say, and others, was the result of inhumane police brutality that is perpetuated by a culture of white supremacy. What happened to George Floyd was not the result of a bad apple. It was indeed a predictable consequence of a racist and prejudiced system and culture that has treated Black bodies as the enemy from the beginning. What happened to George Floyd in Minneapolis is the fruit born of toxic seeds planted on the shores of our country in Jamestown in 1619, when the first enslaved men and women arrived on this continent. Floyd is the latest in the long list of names that stretches back to that time and that shore. Some of the names that we know are Ahmaud Arbery, who was driving while Black, Breonna Taylor, who was sleeping in her home, and countless others, Oscar Grant, Eric Gardner, Trayvon Martin, Michael Brown, Emmett Till, Martin Luther King Jr., and most we do not know. The officers who murdered George Floyd, who stole him from those who loved him, must be brought to justice. At the same time, we must embark on the more complicated work of delivering justice for all the victims of state-sponsored violence and racism. And today, people, all that are with us at this moment, I ask you to please join me in doing the work to ensure that we deconstruct deconstruct racist structures. To that end, we must dismantle white supremacy. And when I say white supremacy, I'm just stating a belief that white people are superior to those of all other races, especially the Black race, and should therefore dominate society. And I just want to be clear, you do not have to be just white in order to engage in white supremacy. In fact, people of all colors, especially socialized in this country, not only engage in white supremacy, but perpetuate those systems as well. So with that, I'd like to share an anthem that I think would motivate us to dismantle white supremacist culture. We collectively have all the energies that we need in order to dismantle these white supremacist cultures. I would like to provide some disclosures. Even though I'm a member of the Board of Trustees for the American Psychiatric Association and a consultant for the People's Preparatory Charter School, these are the views of myself, not necessarily those of the organizations that I belong to. I do not have any conflicts of interest to disclose. However, I do have some beliefs that I think are important for you all to know. One, I believe that race is a social construct, not a biological construct. I do not believe that physiological racial differences provide explanations for health disparity. Racism, both historical and contemporary, is the root cause for health disparities that we see both nationally and globally, and that eradication of racism, if it were up to Black people or other people of color, which is POC, it would have been resolved a long time ago. So governmental agencies like the National Institutes of Health, the Substance Abuse for Mental Health and Services Administration, white people and white organizations must work together to dismantle racism and co-lead the charge to do so. And understanding this is essential for helping Black people live more equitable lives. The objectives of our time together are fourfold. One, I'm going to define key concepts that contribute to the oppression, pain, and overwhelming health disparities among Black and other minoritized communities. I use the word minoritized and not minority because in the world, Black and brown people are actually the majority. But then in the United States, they are systematically minoritized and made to feel less than. So that's the term that I use. Two, we're going to use the opioid epidemic as an example of structural racism that results in negative outcomes for Black people and other people of color. I'm going to be so quick, guys, describe conditions that have contributed to the overrepresentation of Black people in the current COVID-19 pandemic. And then finally, I'm going to describe anti-Black racist practices that many on this call can get involved in that will promote a more just and equitable future for Black and other people of color. So let's start off with language. Racism, race and ism. All that means is that it's a system based on race. And there are many different definitions for racism, but this definition is from one of my mentors, Dr. Kamara Jones, and I really appreciate it. She says, racism, the system of race, structures opportunity and assigns value based on the social interpretation of how one looks, which we deem as race. As a result of racism, it unfairly disadvantages some individuals and communities. It unfairly advantages other individuals and communities. And it saps the strength of the whole society through the waste of human resources. And here I just add that one group of people under racism, usually white people, are systematically advantaged and assigned more value, where those assigned to other groups, usually Black people, are viewed as less than. Race is a social construct, and it results in harmful consequences. And as we'll see through this presentation, those harmful consequences indeed can include death. There's a quote, and I don't know who to give credit to, but it's been said a lot in Black communities. Some colleagues don't like it, but I think it does nicely describe what happens in this country as a result of structural racism. And that is, when someone sneezes, white people get sick, but Black people get pneumonia. And this is just summarizing the extent of which Black people suffer under the existing structures in this country. So let's break down racism a little more. This is me and Dr. Kamara Jones at a conference where I met her. She breaks it down in three different ways: institutionalized racism, personal mediated racism, and internalized racism. I'm going to go through each. Institutionalized racism are policies that result in differential access to the goods, services, and opportunities of society based on race. Example might be policies in housing, educational policies, employment policies, and policies in medical facilities. This is different than personally mediated racism, which is the differential assumption about the abilities, motives, and intents of others by race. So some examples of personally mediated racism that have been really at the forefront of our society is police brutality, where we're seeing that police automatically feel that Black people are inherently more dangerous just by their assigned race. Other examples are physician disrespect. And this is well documented in the literature, where physicians, whether they're Black or white, although it tends to be with more white providers, are less likely to go over the risks, benefits, and side effect profiles of medication with Black patients. They don't spend as much time with Black patients as they do with white patients. And the motives of their Black patients are thought to be more negative as compared to white patients. Other examples of shopkeeper vigilance, of personally mediated racism, is shopkeeper vigilance and teacher devaluation. Shopkeeper vigilance is when a Black person will go into a store and be followed because the inherent assumption is that they're going to steal. That happened to Oprah, and Lord knows, if it happened to Oprah, it can happen to any Black person in this country because she's a billionaire, and that shows that money can't buy you protection from racism. Finally, the last level of racism is internalized racism, which is accepted by the stigmatized races of the negative messages about your own abilities or intrinsic worth. And we see this a lot of times with the performance of Black people in this country, especially students, self-devaluation, resignation, helplessness, and hopelessness that things are never going to change, and they indeed have no value. Another interesting one is this white man's ice is colder, And really, that is the belief that any type of goods or services from a white establishment actually is better, even though ICE is ICE is ICE. But the bottom line is the belief that ICE is better from the white man. Now, I want to center some more concepts. So we've gone over racism. We've gone under different levels of racism. I want to bring you to the broadest umbrella, which is structural racism. And that includes public policy, so that is encompassing of institutionalized racism, institutional practices, cultural representation, that encompasses personally mediated racism, and other norms that reinforce ways to perpetuate racial group inequity. And I like this sign that was on Twitter. It says, "This is not about one man. This is about structural racism in a country built on Black slavery." So this is just bringing into fruition that the very people who actually built this country that were brought here against their will in 1619 are the ones that are suffering the most under the structurally racist norm. Other concepts that we must understand is that of white privilege. Another way to think of white privilege is historical privilege. So that just means that a historical and contemporary advantage for white people and access to quality education, decent jobs, livable wages, home ownership, retirement benefits, etc. And it's important for white people and other non-Black folks to understand that just by inherently the race category that they're assigned to, that they do confer some privilege under these structures. Finally, I'd like to introduce the concept of racial equity. I see this as not aspirational, but actually a very real goal that can be accomplished if we collectively commit to deconstructing systemic racism. So racial equity is a genuine non-racist society where the distribution of benefits and burdens would not be skewed by race. It's not always going to be good, but the disproportionate amount of burden would not just be on Black people, but be shared amongst everyone. This also was on Twitter, and I thought it was really powerful. It's a privilege to learn about racism without experiencing it your whole life. So for all the non-Black folks that are on this, I just want you to understand, because people say, oh, I don't have a privilege. And I will say, just the fact that you don't have to deal with racism on an everyday basis or experience it your whole life is indeed a privilege. So with that, I want to share a quick video, a TED Talk that centers what we're talking about here.
This was my first year teaching, but I had pulled off a slamming lecture and I was feeling good about myself. As I left the classroom, I looked down at my phone and saw that I had 5 missed calls from my brother, Kenny. At the time, Kenny was a student at Temple University and living in North Philly. For those who don't know North Philly, it's an area that is predominantly Black and low income with a very visible police presence. When I return his phone call, Kenny is loud and swearing into the phone. I can tell that something very bad happened, but I'm not sure what. When I'm finally able to get him to calm down, he tells me how he was sitting on the stoop of his building talking to a friend when 4 police officers ran up on him and threw him and 3 others on the ground, handcuffed them, and then pushed them up against a wall, all the while asking them, "What drugs do you have? What drugs do you have?"
I just wanted to share that because this is the everyday experience of many Black folks in this country. She was centering that of her brother, who was indeed a college student, who was just hanging out on his stoop, and the police came, again, personally mediated racism, and assumed that he was a drug dealer, roughed him up, and only left him alone when he was able to produce his freedom card, i.e. his student card. Another thing that I think is important for people to understand during this lecture is the fact that she was doing so well that day. She was a professor, had just had an amazing class, and just the experience of bearing witness to the racism experienced by her brother ruined her whole day. So here, this is the collective trauma that doesn't necessarily always make it to the mainstream media, but it's important to show that these incidences happen every single day. And even though you don't know about them, just know that your colleagues are dealing with them. And so figuring out how can you be an ally to support people who this is their everyday experience. So this is a good time to go into the concept of othering. And this was a concept that was introduced by French philosopher Lucie Arrigaga, and she talked about the conception of othering as the difference from the ideal identity. And we're talking about the ideal identity in the United States. We're talking about a white, Anglo-Saxon, Protestant, cisgender, heterosexual male. And so the further you get away from that ideal identity, the more other you are, and the more prosecution that you will face in this country. The Oxford Dictionary says an other, or to be other, is just to view or treat a person or a group of people different from or alien to oneself. Being left out of the conversation of mainstream America, othering has resulted in a limited focus of funding on research that directly affects racial and ethnic minorities, or treatment modalities that respect cultural and historical atrocities. And this is important because when we think about COVID-19 that I'll talk about in a bit, and we think about the opioid epidemic, and we think about how people, Black people, receive care in this country, it is a result of othering because their cultural values are not centered in the treatment. It's all based on this ideal identity, usually which is white folks. We know underrepresented minorities, racial and ethnic minorities, are made to feel less than the majority population. We saw that through racism, the system based on race. And I think what's infuriating as people put out these statements in the context of the most recent wave of police murders is that there are no amends made by predominantly white institutions of power to correct this dynamic. So that's one of the reasons why I had to start off this talk with public enemies, fight the power. Because if we are ever able to really get equitable results in this country, we have to call on the accountability of these predominantly white institutions. So as an example of othering, because I am an addiction psychiatrist and so much of what I do is centered around treating people with substance use disorders, I wanted to use the opioid epidemic as a case study of how Black people are othered in this country. Here, I'm showing you a graph. On the x-axis is just years up until 2016. On the y-axis is deaths per 100,000. And the lines are just different types of drug overdoses by type of opioid. The point is that there's a huge spike in drug overdoses involving fentanyl, which is a synthetic opioid. And the most increase or drastic increase of fentanyl has been by Black and Latinx people. But this is not centered in mainstream America. We continue to hear about white bodies, but we do not hear about the drastic increases in death amongst Black people or Latinx people, which for Black people, there was a rise by 140.6% and by Latinx, 118%. Why is that? Again, because of structural racism, because of othering, and I'm gonna show you that. So despite this data, again, here we see that in 8 states and the District of Columbia, that there are more Black people that are dying from opioid-related death rates as opposed to white people. And again, this is not over the mainstream news. Even when opioids, even before COVID-19, when opioids were a big deal, these states were not given funding at an increased rate to deal with the Black opioid-related overdose rates. This was not covered by the mainstream media. In fact, many people still don't understand this. So again, why is this the case? Because inherently, whether it's conscious or unconscious, there is this thought that white people inherently have more value. Then what really upset me as a community engaged researcher is that there was an article that came out in October of last year that said there is a persistent funding gap for Black scientists from the major research institution in this country, which is the National Institutes of Health. And the NIH director, Francis Collins, showing his white privilege, said he was surprised by these findings and that it was because of research topic choice. And we have to do more research to understand what is the reason for the disparity. Is it because the Black scientists have a weaker methodology? Again, personally mediated racism. Why would there be an assumption that the Black scientists have a weaker methodology? How can this be a surprise when Black researchers, including myself, have understood that there have been funding caps from the NIH for years? So in response to that white privilege, Dr. Carl Hart and I decided to write an editorial, a response. And what we said is that the authors of this paper did not even discuss the role of racism in understanding this funding gap, nor did they talk about the disproportionate, unjust, or unfair treatment of Black scientists that may result from overwhelmingly majority white study sections. What we know is that Black scientists are more likely to actually investigate topics such as racial discrimination, racism, health disparities, because it disproportionately affects them and the people that they care for. So that's another reason why we don't see culturally informed practices in terms of the opioid epidemic, for example, because Black scientists are more likely to do this work, but least likely to be funded. And then finally, we offered some solutions to this funding gap, which was not centered at all in the paper. Can we have an equity factor score or supplement to account for the Black scientists that come from lower quintile schools with fewer resources, which we know can affect their ability to receive funding? So again, I'm just giving this an example in the ways in which our structures that we depend on, like the NIH, can inherently be racist against Black folks. Another way the opioid epidemic shows us racist practices is the regulatory agency. Again, I treat predominantly Black and Brown folks with opioid use disorder. This is not going to speak to them or their experience in using drugs, mainly heroin or cocaine spiked with fentanyl. This is what the National Alliance of Advocates for Buprenorphine, their treatment site has. A white girl who is like, looks like an angel, angelic. This is not speaking to their experience. Also, if you go to find a buprenorphine provider, again, it's like a white man, working class. It does not show any other people that might need to find a buprenorphine provider. Then I thought Vivitrol was a little bit better because at least this woman was like racially ambiguous. I was like, maybe she's Latina, I don't know. But again, if we just talk about othering, she's fair skinned, the provider is white, and again, is not speaking to the broad experiences of what people look like with the opioid use disorder in this country. Just showing you more of the same. I said, okay, let me look at my specialty organization, which is the American Academy of Addiction Psychiatry. Even our specialty organizations perpetuate racist stereotypes. Here, this came to my Twitter account. No one chooses to develop opioid use disorder, but you can choose to treat it. Again, centering whiteness with this white woman who may have an opioid use disorder, but not speaking to the experiences of different Black people or people of color. So all these institutions are implicit in perpetuating these racist practices. I just wanted to center that opioids are not the only crisis. While we spend so much time on centering whiteness and white people in the opioid crisis, I just want people to understand that cocaine is the number two killer of all the illicit drugs. And in fact, cocaine kills more Black people than opioids do. And as a result of the Anti-Drug Abuse Act, again, which is a law that was put into place in this country, is a racist one because it preferentially has harsher penalties for crack cocaine versus powder cocaine, which is more likely to be abused, crack cocaine, by Black people as opposed to white people. And this resulted in a sentencing disparity that still accounts disproportionate amounts of Black people behind bars today. So here is Wendell Pierce. He's a famous actor that acted in The Wire. He said, crack epidemic destroys a poor Black community. It's the war on drugs, which is what we see still to this day. The opioid epidemic destroys a poor white community. It's a national public health crisis. So just the way our country responds to different addictions is based on race. So we cannot continue to bury our heads in the sand and pretend like everybody's treated the same in this country, even by our laws, because that is not the case. All right. The war on drugs is one that targeted low-income people and a war on minorities. And here I'm just showing you data to just raise into your consciousness the lifetime likelihood of imprisonment of white people versus Black people versus Latinx people. And this is important because if you have a record in this country, it dictates where you're able to work, where you're able to live, where your children are able to live, what resources you're able to access, employment opportunities, educational opportunities. And as you can just see, overall, the lifetime likelihood of imprisonment for men is 1 in 9. For white men, that goes down to 1 in 17. For Black men, it's 1 in 3. That is just mind-boggling. I hope that this is infuriating to you and it makes you think, what can I do to be involved to deconstruct a policy or a law that would allow a Black man to have a lifetime likelihood of imprisonment to be 1 in 3. For Latinx men, 1 in 6. Looking for all women, 1 in 56 lifetime likelihood. For white women, this goes down drastically. 1 out of 111. For Black women, 1 in 18. Latinx women, 1 in 45. So here I'm just centering how structures can inherently be racist, and again, preferentially advantaging one group of people versus the other. This is just showing you arrests, Black versus white. Black is at the top, white is at the bottom. This goes to 2000, so this data is a bit old, but unfortunately, the gap has not minimized much. Black people are way more likely to be arrested than white people because of their substance use. Here, it says, this is what I call a handy enforcement tool. And it says, the officer holding a flashlight that says drug laws, and it skips over the white guy and goes straight to the black guy. This is important because a lot of what I have described up until this point is foundational for understanding why we have more risk of infection amongst Black people in the current COVID-19 pandemic, and also why more Black people are actually dying as a result of the pandemic. It has nothing to do with physiologic principles. We have to eliminate that. It's nothing that Black people are doing intentionally. It's a result of these racist policies that have been put in place either through the Healthcare Administration, Housing Administration, Employment Administration, or our laws that quote unquote govern this country. As a syndemic, we're not just dealing with one pandemic, which the major media would like to have you think. We're dealing with COVID-19 and structural racism in Black community. And what we know is that structural racism has always been there, and now we're just introducing COVID-19. So it's therefore important to understand that these structural inequalities were already in place prior to COVID-19, and that this virus has just accentuated what Black people in this country have been experiencing for years, for centuries even, that of racist policies and practices. This data is from the latest article from David Williams and Lisa Cooper that came out in JAMA May 11th, 2020, and also from the health equity report that just came out by the Chicago Urban League. Here I'm just showing you what we know. Black people are overrepresented in COVID-19 cases and death. Black people died disproportionately from COVID-19 in 19 of the 24 states that have data available by race, because not all of them have, and that the worst disparities in death rates are in the states that have the most segregated cities. So thus, Illinois, Michigan, Indiana, Missouri. Black people actually, the death rate was more than double than the population that they share. And in Wisconsin, 39% of the deaths were among Black people, even though they only make up 6% of the population. And finally, in Illinois, Black people make up the majority of death at every age point except age 80 or older. So here we're seeing that even though Black people make up the least amount of the population in these states, they have the highest mortality rate. In the next two slides, I'm just explaining from the Chicago Urban League the data about why more Black people are likely to get infected by COVID-19. And it's largely due to structural racism. Okay? One, employment and occupational conditions. Black people only make up 13% of the workforce, but are overrepresented in service sectors where they are not able to physically distance or practice social distancing, or they are considered essential. So those are things like the travel industry, where Black people make up about a quarter of those who are the baggage handlers and do reservation or ticketing, and healthcare support. So Black people are more than a quarter represented in terms of psychiatric or home health aid
or respiratory therapists where there's a high risk of getting the virus. Black people are overrepresented in these employment conditions. Food service, the postal service, transportation, et cetera, you're getting the point. Black people tend to be in jobs where they are unable to keep themselves safe and unable to practice physical or social distancing. And that's related to employment opportunities in this country, based on educational opportunities in this country, that are all go back to our laws and how people are treated based on race. Then if we look at housing, one of the biggest factors that we know determines your ability to stay safe is how you're able to distance. Black people actually make up the majority of the existence in homeless populations in Chicago, even though they're only 30% of the population. And unfortunately, we see that in major segregated cities. They don't have the luxury of isolating. I always tell people, you just can't tell people to put on masks and isolate. Not everybody has that luxury. It's a privilege to be able to live somewhere in order to practice social distancing. And we saw that in New York City, where people had to actually leave their house in order to actually practice social distancing because it wasn't possible in the places where they live. Overcrowded conditions, intergenerational living, nearly a quarter of Black households are intergenerational, meaning that you have grandparents that are raising children who are the most vulnerable to COVID-19. And so we have people being infected, not because they want to, but that's because that is their housing structure. Then if we think of what are some natural barriers that exist in the community that lead to an inability to social distance, those are things like lack of internet access. So everybody's talking about, oh, you can see your doctor through technology. Well, only 66% of Black people have broadband access at home compared to 80% of whites. And you might say, oh, 66%, that's not bad. But if you think about how are they accessing their internet? From the Pew Research data, we know that most Black people don't have laptops at home, that they access it through their smartphone. And I can tell you they're not gonna use their minutes to engage with the doctor if they have to communicate with family or use that to pay bills, et cetera. So also, just this idea of wearing a mask, I was watching CNN and Dr. Oz, again showing his white privilege, just said, oh, if you don't have a mask, you can just put a red bandana on your face. What are you talking about, Dr. Oz? If you put a red bandana on for so many Black people, you will get killed, depending on what neighborhood you live in. Also, we know that there are preferential policing practices where in Philadelphia, they actually pulled Black folks off of the bus if they did not have access to a proper hospital mask, if they were just using a scarf or a bandana. So here we see that people are treated differently based on how they look. Finally, let's not forget the effects of mass incarceration, which is one of the most unjust structural institutions in this country, where there is overrepresentation of Black folks. And we see that with COVID-19, if you are in correctional facilities, there's a higher risk of transmission by the virus because of over-aggregation of people, and that Black people are more likely to be detained for imprisonment. So that means waiting in jail until they can post bail, which also increases the risk of getting COVID-19. So even before you're charged and you have to go for sentencing, you have to be in prison. I mean, you have to be in jail waiting. And many Black people cannot afford the funds to get released from detainment, which is another, again, issue of structural racism. So then if we go on and say, okay, we know that for all these reasons, Black people are more likely to get infected, but why are they more likely to die? So let's center that. And we see that they're also more likely to die by COVID-19 because of structural racism. So in places where there's hyper segregation, so that means cities where there are high levels of Black poverty and places where Black people live that isolate them from other communities, there is a larger inequity. And those are places like Milwaukee, St. Louis, Washington, D.C., New Orleans, where Black deaths are more than 50% of the population compared to white people. As high as 72% in St. Louis, as high as 79% in D.C., and as high as 76% in New Orleans. And these are cities in which there's no opportunity for advancement. Let's not forget racism in healthcare. I don't know why people like to say racial discrimination. I guess it makes them feel better, but racism is the same thing as racial discrimination. The bottom line is that there is inherent discrimination amongst healthcare providers. I told you in the beginning that Black people have that physician disrespect where they are treated poor from healthcare providers. They're less likely to be referred for diagnostic testing. They have fewer referrals to specialty care, and we see that all the time with people with substance use disorders where literally I'll have patients that are not referred for Suboxone treatment, which is the treatment for opioid use disorder, one of the treatments, whereas my white folks who are more from affluent areas or might be from Yale are actually referred to more. And then if we look at people who are not incarcerated, Black people actually have less access to healthcare because in this country, a lot of times insurance is based on, or the type of insurance you have is based on your employment. So if people are working in these jobs, they might not have access to good healthcare, and then they're not able to engage in the system. So then they're more likely to get infections and not be treated because they can't afford to, or they're scared because they're worried about the bills, et cetera. We talked about this already, so I don't want to belabor the point because I want to make sure that we have time for Q&A. But again, there's a huge gap in wealth amongst Black and white people in this country. In 2018, the percentage of Black people living in poverty was about 2 times that of whites living in poverty. So 22% versus 9%. Black households earn 70% less on average than white households. And this is important, guys, because it's like, well, Dr. Jordan, what does this have to do with COVID-19? Because depending on what money you have, depends on where you live, where you can send your children to school, where you can educate yourself, access to different types of hospitals, being able to pay for your medication, being able to practice preventative care. None of these things can happen if you're living in abject poverty. And then finally, Black people are more likely to have pre-existing health conditions. Again, not because of some physiologic process that happens only in Black people genetically versus white people, but it's because of all of these structures that we talked about that do not allow for people to take care of themselves in the same way. And even if they do have access to insurance and they do go to the doctor, they're more likely, if you're Black, to be treated differently. So when we look at asthma, Black people are more likely to experience asthma compared to white people. Why is that? We think about literally differential access to clean air. More wasteland and pollution tend to be in lower income Black or other people of color neighborhoods. Black people are more likely to experience cardiovascular disease. Rates of hypertension are diagnosed 35% higher amongst Blacks compared to whites. Why is that the case? Some colleagues just, again, published an article about these health disparities in JAMA, looking at these disparities. It's related to, again, neighborhood, access to healthy foods, living in places with food deserts, meaning that there's no access to healthy options. Being exposed to trauma. There is an article coming out that I was just involved in that talks about secondary trauma. So what we're seeing, the death, the murders of all these Black people that can cause inability to sleep, inability to regulate your physiology, leading to increased hypertension, okay? What about trauma, PTSD, mental health issues? These are all not necessarily higher in Black folks, but they go untreated in Black people. Black people are twice as likely to report psychological hardships, yet only a third of them actually get treatment. And that is treatment both in outpatient services, in counseling, and also in terms of medication. So what do we do here, people? How do we even begin to deal with all of these structural racist policies or social inequities, whatever you feel most comfortable? And I say is, one, we have to understand the social determinants of health, of which racism is one of them. So the WHO, World Health Organization, when they define social determinants of health, they say it's inequities in health and avoidable, that's the key word, avoidable health inequalities which arise because of the circumstances in which people grow, live, work, and age. And what I am trying to relate to you today is that these circumstances are based in inherently racist policies that dictate how people that belong to Black race are able to grow, live, work, and age. These conditions in which people live and die are in turn shaped by political, social, and economic forces. This is a wonderful slide that I modified from Dr. A.R. James, who is an amazing OBGYN that talks about disproportionate rates in Black maternal and infant mortality rates in Ohio. And here you just see the social determinants of health, and it's a huge iceberg, and you see all the social determinants of health, or SDOH, that contribute to health disparities, or in this case, sometimes even death amongst Black and other people of color. And I love this little man or little person, let's not assign a gender, in the boat, who is trying to deal with the leak and address the medical problem. And here we can say that this person is never going to move forward unless they deal with all these social determinants that are underlying in this iceberg, right? And so one of the things that I want you to understand is that as a professional, whether you be a health professional, educational professional, what have you, one of the social determinants that you have to reckon with to minimize death and minimize health disparities is that of racism. There's many others here, but racism is at the core of all of these things. I'm nearing the end, and this really spoke to me. This is a woman who was at one of the protests recently, and her sign says, "Stop killing us." And I'd like to take it a step further, because in this poster, she is bringing attention to all the Black people that have been killed unjustly in this country, most of whose murderers continue to roam free. But I implore you to stop killing us, not only in the streets, by police, by private citizens, but also in racist policies, in healthcare, in education, in housing, through technology or lack thereof, by not allowing access to clean air, through racist environmental policies, stop killing us. Through unjust working conditions, stop killing us. So what can be done? What can we do here, people? I just painted a very bleak picture, and that is accurate. It is indeed bleak. Black people are suffering. We've been suffering for years. It's not getting better. Health disparities are worse than they were 40 years ago. So we have to sit in the reality of the pain that Black folks experience, not just when people get killed, but in their everyday existence. Remember, being able to learn about racism and not experience it is indeed a privilege in and of itself. So what can be done? All right, so with that, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has. These are my last slides. What can you do? Where can you start to address the social determinants? It's up to you. You can start wherever you have a consensus, wherever you have the most community buy-in, wherever you have the most talent or strength. Put your money where your values lie to deconstruct racist policy. Fund grassroots and community-based social services that provide wellness to Black communities. Fund faith communities that are working with traditional settings of care to provide counseling and trauma support. Fund groups focused on criminal justice reform, like eliminating cash bond, where we saw where Black folks cannot have to be detained because they can't post bond. Protect essential workers, where we know there's overrepresentation of Black people in jobs where they're not able to physically distance. Make sure that these essential workers have paid sick leave, hazard pay, have access to personal protective equipment. No performative allyship. Most Black people will know who this is. This is Ayana Van Zandt. She always says, do your work. Engage in anti-racist education. One of the things that I'll do is I'll send around a PDF that has resources of so many books and websites and videos where people who want to be allies can engage in some serious work. Don't ask me. I'm sick of white folks, Asian folks, Latinx folks, non-Black folks asking me what they can do. You have to do your work. Do not remain silent. Be heard so that others know you do not condone injustice. Check on your Black friends and colleagues. It's not enough to just say, how are you doing? Give them some provision. One of my good friends who's an ally, a white woman, she sent me some flowers and a note of encouragement. Another ally said, Ayana, this is a difficult time for you. I am going to send you meals for the next couple of weeks. leverage your privilege and really do something that will help others. In times of protest and public outcry, like we're having right now, demand justice by either doing online petitions or making calls to your local representatives. Leverage your own networks to help educate your own folks. I can't always be responsible for educating white folks. You guys need to educate yourself. My Asian brothers and sisters, educate yourselves and your brothers and sisters. Show up. March with Black protesters. Form a line to defend them, because you know that the Black police, sometimes some of them are Black, but the police are going to be least likely to attack white folks than they are Black folks. Financially support organizations on the ground, especially those led by Black and Indigenous or other people of color, and direct others to the resources that you are finding, you're supporting. Black lives matter, all Black lives matter, and we have to be engaged in this for equitable outcome. This is my last slide. Of equality, as if it harmed me. Giving others the same chances and rights as myself, as if it were not indispensable to my own rights, the others possess the same. I'd like to end before we do Q&A, and we have 20 minutes, with a slide that I saw that made me sob, but I'm trying to find a silver lining. Let me stop and share this with you. That was George Floyd, who was murdered by the police officer that cut off his breathing, murdered by asphyxiation. His daughter, in happier times, she said, "Daddy changed the world." Indeed, Daddy changed the world. Please don't let his death be in vain. Please do the work so we can indeed change the world. Thank you. I'm happy to answer any questions.